Okay. This morning at 2:40 a.m., there was a on my door. I looked out the window to assess, map the situation. There was a young bloke at the door. I mapped the situation as reasonably harmless and opened the door. He said, "Sorry, mate, I got the wrong place." He was following a map. I couldn't get back to sleep. And so I spent the time writing this. A few days ago, I stubbed my toe, no great damage, just a temporary discomfort. My map of the floor was not sufficiently accurate. Some humans strap bombs around themselves. Some fly planes into buildings, use biological material to destroy many other humans. They do this based on their belief maps. Humans have traveled through space and drove vehicles on the moon based on scientific maps. Each one of us make maps of our earlier maps and make maps of the maps others make. Mm. You might recognize this in terms of time binding. Maps play a very big part in our relationship with ourselves, others, and the world around us. Our ideas about things, our beliefs, the way we understand things, our expectations, our knowledge, our plans, the way we think, feel, talk about things, our fears, anxieties, hopes, and wishes, the way we label ourselves, others, and the situations we find ourselves in, our memories, can all be considered as maps. We structure our experiences consciously and unconsciously and make maps. And we live by following our maps. I think you will all agree with me that the more accurate our maps, the more up-to-date, the more increments of information we put in our maps, the less harm we will likely do to ourselves and to others, and the greater our chances of improving our relationships with ourselves, with others, and the world we live in. We live in a world of rhythms, changing patterns of activities. We live in a world of relationships and changing relationships. The calculus, as I'm structuring it today, is about the study of changing relationships. You can think of it not only as a very powerful mathematical tool, but also a very powerful psychological tool. It is about developing a more finely tuned awareness, higher levels of awareness and sensitivity to what's going on in and around us. It's about being more in touch with what we are thinking, feeling, saying, and doing, and how we are thinking, feeling, saying, and doing. It's about breaking down complex situations into more manageable bits. It's about making finer distinctions and making better maps. It's about improving our understanding of ourselves, others, and the world. We can use a calculus approach to help us make better plans, better decisions, and take better problem-solving approaches. It can help us learn how to better manage our times, and that's not all. We can use a calculus approach to help us recognize that the ways we structure our experiences and our maps are not the same as the territories they are mapped on. We practice a calculus approach by watching, listening, touching, smelling, and noticing things, and by watching how we watch. We practice a calculus approach by watching, listening, touching, smelling, and noticing things. And by watching how we watch, listen, notice, label, think, feel, talk, and write about things. And that's not all. A calculus approach applies to both our inner and outer worlds. You can use it in any everyday situation. The following experiment exercises my map, my hope that you might get a feel for the calculus approach. You might keep in mind that the more we differentiate, the less we identify. The less we identify our maps with what they might be maps of. So, we'll start with a definition of the calculus. A definition that I like is this one. The study of a continuous function by following its development through indefinitely small steps. Okay? Now you can think of that as a very high order abstraction. So let's use the calculus approach, the little we understand from those words, to help us better understand the calculus approach. You may recognize there that we're talking about being self-reflexive. We can apply the calculus approach to help us understand the calculus approach. So, let's see if we can get some more words for study. See, already we're starting getting little increments. So what are the words we can think of for study?
Learning. Exploration.
Evaluate.
Nice word you have there.
Discover.
Yeah.
Internalize.
Any more you can think of? I have some here from previous seminars.
Training.
Tracking, that's a good one. And we have the processing. Mapping. Structuring.
Predicting.
I don't think I like predicting for study.
Okay.
How about watching? And do we have analyzing yet?
No.
Or analysis?
Is that all?
No, we never have all. We can have exploring, we have exploring. Yes, we have exploring. Investigating. No? And you can add some more to your, I hope you're doing this too. You can have appraising. Now, let's have another one. This time we do, okay. We have
okay.
We have non-stopping.
Ongoing.
Flowing.
Everlasting.
Incessant. Okay. Function. Here, function, we're thinking of function in terms of happening, not in the mathematical, but continuous function. So we'll start with happening.
Event. Process.
Result. Result.
Continuous resultant. Don't like that one. Would you like to elaborate more, find another term there? Continuous result. I put it, but then later on you'll see it works.
Function's a bit more like a relationship, isn't it?
Relation. We have process already happening, operation.
Action.
Activity.
Behavior.
Goings on. Situation. Okay.
It's a state.
We have operation.
Phenomenon.
Okay, so we go to following. We can start with ordering. Yeah, we're back to structuring. You notice how many times some words come back? Structuring. By observing. Looking at.
Exploring.
Exploring comes back. Investigation. We have attending to. Monitoring. Analyzing. Noticing. And okay. Going.
Changing.
Unfolding. And development could also mean decay. Change, we have changing, evolution, growth, fulfillment, progress. We have progress, yes. Okay. Maybe you can put emergence. Through indefinitely small steps. Okay. What do we have for indefinitely small steps? Start with minute. Yeah?
Little by little.
Baby.
Tiny.
tiny. And this one came from Vassar, or maybe not. But I remember who said it. It was Irene Maple. Itsy,
bitsy,
teeny. Teeny, that's it.
Teeny.
Teeny, microscopic.
Sub-microscopic.
Or we can put sub if you want. We can have very, very, yeah, and
very small.
Incremental.
Don't you mean very, very small?
Hmm?
Don't you mean very, very small?
Which one?
Which one? Just very, very.
Very, very, but you have small ears. We're just doing indefinitely. Indefinitely. Or we can keep the whole thing, indefinitely small steps, okay? So incremental. But in some of these, you might have to put the steps when you do the next assignment.
Minuscule.
So, minuscule, good. See, each time I do this, I got some more words over the past 25 years or so.
The mathematician would say asymptotically reducing.
I don't know if you have time. Okay, here's your assignment now. If you can use these words you have here to come up with your own definition of the calculus by using the words to make a sentence, right? So you can choose a word from each section to make a sentence and come up with your own definition of the calculus, and then it will have more meaning for you. And imagine that you're going to explain it to somebody who has no idea about the calculus. Or you're going to explain it to a five-year-old. You could explain it to a five-year-old. Yourself and your children and your posterity. So,
you mean just come silent and just read it?
I'll start it off. Do you want me to read it up or write it down?
No, just read it.
Just read it, okay. Okay, my definition is the tracking of a flowing process by observing its evolution through indefinitely small changes.
Okay, could you give that again?
The tracking of a flowing process, like say a wave, by observing its evolution through indefinitely small changes.
Can you pick up?
Through indefinitely small changes.
Well, observing its evolution through indefinitely small changes.
Good.
Thanks.
Thank you. Now you see, from each person's definition, you can combine and improve on it or improve on yours. Okay? Next.
It's evolution through indefinitely small changes.
I think Campbell's approach to everyday living is to explore the non-stopping behaviour and observe the general growth through mini steps.
You read that again?
To observe the non-stopping behaviour and observe general growth through mini steps.
Mini.
My definition of calculus, an investigation of an ever-changing phenomenon by monitoring its unfolding through incremental small steps.
Mm-hmm. Don't be afraid to use teeny, weeny, and bitsy.
evaluating a never-ending happening by observing its evolution through itsy-bitsy, teeny-weeny steps.
Good.
A never-ending happening by observing its evolution through itsy-bitsy, teeny-weeny steps.
Yes, it's important that we get in itsy-bitsy, teeny-weeny. Sometimes we take these things too seriously.
What's the bottom one under, by following, ordering, is that called?
Noticing, studying.
Studying,
The exploration of an everlasting event by observing changing to indefinitely minute increments.
Good. You want to read it again?
The exploration of an everlasting event by observing changes to indefinitely minute increments.
And you got no help from your mother, right?
No. But I'm coming from him.
It's different
from
the others. The analysis of the incessant situation, something like that, by studying the emergence of minuscule bits.
Okay. It's yours, and you have a lifetime to improve on it.
Thanks, Paul.
The evaluation of a continuous process by observing its development through many small steps.
Okay, I'll bring up the rear with a statement that it's the evaluation of an ongoing process by monitoring its progress through increasingly small steps.
Good. Now, can you think of anything that you could not apply the calculus approach to? Think of when you're driving along. Think of your relationships with a friend or the home, a wife, a girlfriend. Think of attending a class and not recognizing that you're daydreaming and you're thinking of somewhere else. Can you think of anything that you couldn't apply it to?
Not off.
What about one's
career?
You can apply it to your
career.
Yes,
that's right. Oh, yeah.
No,
I thought.
No,
yeah. Oh,
yes. I wonder about a binary decision, to be or not to be, is the question, you know. Should I marry this person? The outcome is a yes or no, except, of course, that you can modify it by saying maybe you live together for a while or maybe this or that. But a lot of decisions are a binary choice. Mm-hmm. Now, the examination might be a calculus approach. Can I learn more and more and more and increasingly fine detail about this person or about the factors that go into the decision, but the outcome is a binary question, isn't it? It's either yes or no, one or not, to be or not to be.
Except that you have increased the increments of information about the person.
Certainly.
A few weeks ago I defined love, romantic people might not like this, love as an example of highly uncritical thinking. In terms of more information, some years ago I was working at a hospital in Montreal, Canada, and there were two ladies who used to go for lunch each day, and they enjoyed their lunchtime together. They were practicing psychologists. They enjoyed their lunchtime together to the extent that they decided to rent out a suite of apartments and work together. Mm. It lasted 6 months. And they're not speaking to each other. They may have started speaking to each other again, but it just broke up. Mm. And when I spoke with one of them, part of the problem was when you go to lunch, you don't do some domestic things. Mm. And when they are in their department or apartment business, one person did not wash up the things. They left it for the other person to do. And the other person naturally rebelled. So many times we go into a situation with a minuscule amount of information, and we make our plans and decisions based on that small amount of information. So here is something else we can do again to illustrate what we're talking about. Suppose, for instance, you wanted carpets for your living room. So you order carpets and you have this length times width as your area, right? You measure this and you ordered your carpet, okay? And you could be reasonably sure that you'd get the size carpet you ordered. Now suppose your living room was like this. Now if you decide to just measure length times width, and carpets were very, very expensive, right? Then you'd have too much there, right? And suppose you decided then that, okay, I don't want to waste so much. So what I'll do is I'll measure this way. Okay? And so now you don't have that included. Okay? But if you want to get an accurate, more accurate mapping of your living room, okay, you could now say, okay, it looks tedious, but it's the principle that is involved. You could say, okay, I will remember the itsy bitsy steps. Okay? And now you said, okay, I can use the same mathematical principle n times width. So you would go here. You get the idea? And you'll have a certain degree of accuracy. Okay? And suppose you said, okay, it's not accurate enough. So we'll make itsy bitsy bits. Get any idea? So the closer, the smaller these little strips, the more accurate you're mapping. And you can think of the smaller strips as increments of information. Increments of information. And you're mapping this, and the more increments of information you have, the better map, the more accurate your map. Okay? Because it's a matter of adding up the dimensions of these little strips, and the closer the strips are, the more accurate. And you can think of it as increments of information about anything. If you listen closely to things, you hear more. If you look closer or look more, get more increments of information, right? If you feel the texture of things, you get more information than just looking at it. Yeah. Any comments so far?
Well, yeah, that suggests to me that if you're planning an operation, if you're planning a project, future project, and that you look for increments of information. The more increments of information you get, the more likely your predictions will be accurate.
Yeah. How about problem solving?
Chop the problem down into small little bits and solve them bit by bit.
You could get a piece of string and put that around the edge and measure the string, and you'd have the outside of it.
But not the area.
But you didn't get the principle that I'm trying to It would certainly work, but I'm trying to. It's not so much measurement we're talking about here as the principle behind a calculus approach to everyday situations. So what we're going to do now is to apply that principle to a bit of music that I have here. I've had this piece of music for about 35 years. Still going strong, remember relative invariance principle. Okay. Has remained relatively invariant in terms of how it sounds over 35 years. So just listen closely to this. Once we play it right through once, and write down your impression of it. Your impression, whatever comes to mind. It's just one sentence, two sentences. You don't need more than that. Or you can just give it a label. Thank you. Make an adjustment to see if we can get a little bit more clarity. But in the meanwhile, you can tell me your first order impression of what you heard.
I thought it was going to be one of those like ones with no talking or anything at the beginning, but then it was really wrong.
The lyrics kicked in.
So when you say there's going to be more clarity, do you mean you purposely distorted that one?
No,
I couldn't hear any distortion.
I didn't hear the words clearly enough.
No, I found the lyrics not.
It's too much bass.
I didn't know what you meant, although I could understand them because I heard
them so often.
Yeah, same here.
So maybe if we take off some of the bass, it may give us more treble and then the voice may come up some more.
I don't know the song. I know the tune. It sounded that it might have been a sad story with a happy tune. I couldn't quite get the lyrics.
Catchy tune, gay, carefree, got a very sad story. They not told us. They told us that we're a happy tale. It's all contradictory.
First of all, I thought it was a bit old school, country.
The oldies.
Not so, not so appealing to me, but after a while, it sort of grew on me, and I sort of felt the rhythm and started to travel with it. Yeah, it's
good. Well, I wrote down rhythm and repetition and evoked in me a sense of continuity involved in incremental small steps. Mm-hmm. I found it pleasant and exhilarate, quite sort of refreshing, and I was reminded of a previous set of seminars many and I did years ago where music was an integral part of the seminar. Mm-hmm. And our two presenters and the Ma presenter would, whenever we were going to have a break, would play a particular piece of music just before the break, and after the break, before we resumed, play another piece. I found that very effective.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's
yes, that was a familiar music for me, being old enough to have recalled it from childhood, I think,
mm-hmm.
or young adulthood.
Yeah.
So I was familiar with the music, but I don't recall the lyrics of it, and couldn't very quite understand the words. But to me, I think it's a dark sort of a story, a troubling sort of a story.
Mm-hmm.
Not just sad, but troubling. And yet it's a nice, bouncy sort of a rhythm, of course, yes. So there's a bit of a contradiction for me in that. It's a troubling, dark sort of a story, I think.
Well, I didn't get that impression at all.
Yes, but for me the music doesn't convey it, but I think lyrics do.
So would somebody then, if somebody heard this story, could somebody relate the story as you heard it? What was the story about? Didn't hear enough. Okay.
Oh, well, I just thought it was.
Okay.
He was telling the story of his life. I'm the son of the local tramp.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but my mum's not what she would have been.
It's about visitors.
The son of the local tramp.
I meant the world, you know, the mum's not what she should be.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's listen again, and this time, see if you can focus on the orchestration.
Could I just say one thing? I said it was a catchy tune, music. Gay and carefree, music. But a very sad story. They're not music. Told as if it were sad, but a happy tale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Contradictory, the whole thing. Yeah.
Okay, this time we listen to the orchestration. We won't play it right through, but see if you can pick up some of the orchestration. Okay. Did you hear that little piece? As if there was it's a story, and we have come to one chapter and moving off to another chapter.
Well, I picked up, it produced a theme and then a variation,
mm-hmm.
and I was expecting it to return to the theme.
Okay, that's what you heard, or what you structured.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. No, I heard sort of the relative inverts of the background beat, the that goes through the whole thing, mm-hmm. even though it changed a little bit, it's still the same sort of repeated rhythm.
Okay. Okay, let's listen and see if we can now hear the voices or the lyrics in relationship to the orchestration. This is how the orchestration supports the lyrics. Okay, go. The lyrics and see that relationship. Okay.
Mama passed away, left the ones who loved her. Each and every one more than grateful for whatever.
Did you hear difference there?
No guitar. No guitar in that bit.
No,
just
the drums.
Yeah, it's kind of empty.
Yeah,
right, to match the
hollow words or hollow feeling might feel like mum had gone away.
Yeah. And also, if you listen to the drums, it was kind of a tup-tup-tup-tup, kind of turbulence there.
Hectic.
Yes. Okay. Okay. This time we're going to play it right through. And you've been to the airport and. You've seen a radar scan. So you scan across the sound that you hear, focusing on the orchestration, the lyrics, the background voices, the change in the instrumentation and all that kind of thing. So just scan across and listen very closely. So we're going to listen now and scan.
I don't know what you mean. What do you mean?
Listening very closely to the different happenings, the orchestration, the lyrics, the way the orchestration supports the lyrics, the changes in the instrumentation, like that empty spot that we, relatively empty spot we heard there, those kind of things. Okay?
No, just draw something first, Milton.
Thank you.
So sometimes we have to look some more, listen some more, pay more attention.
By doing the exercises you gave us before we listened to it the last time, mm-hmm. all the way through, was a lot more beneficial to actually picking up the subtle changes yeah. as a result of the practice of doing that, mm-hmm. looking for those sorts of things.
Yeah. See, I've been listening to it for over 35 years. So I have more information about it than you have listening for the first time.
Yes, so I can't help associating that song with sitting around on beanbags, drinking rough red and talking philosophy all night. that's about the day job, isn't it?
He's talking cordial.
It's cordial, yes. Rough red,
cordial. But remember, it's not about the song. I use the song to help illustrate the notion of the calculus.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the example what you're doing here is we're analysing the music in small steps, mm-hmm. smaller and smaller.
Yeah.
And then if you want to, once you've analysed it in small steps, you can integrate it all back together again. Okay? Mm-hmm.
Yes, so we differentiate to better integrate. Right? And that's part of what we do in our everyday situation. We just don't call it that. Oh, we think about things and we notice things and without making any effort, our nervous system puts it together and come out with maps. So the maps we have depends a great deal on the amount of information that we gather. Because we don't have to teach our nervous system how to make maps. So it's important that we get more information, more up-to-date information, so that we can have better maps. Remember, that's not all, but it's a start, and you can apply this to any situations. I give a little bit of how I came across this field of the calculus. In Science and Sanity, Callaghan keep mentioned the calculus and has a chapter on the semantics of the calculus. I read it and couldn't figure out what the calculus had to do with everyday situations. And I was mulling over this, contemplating, trying to figure out how to make sense of the calculus, mathematical equations, and everyday situations. And one day, after several weeks of this trying to make sense of this, I was parking the car in the underground garage. And there were columns, there were garbage boxes, there were other cars, there were tight spaces, and I had to watch, I moved slowly and watch the continuous function. There was my trying to get out of the parking garage, and it suddenly came to me. I was watching closely so as not to hit columns or other cars. I was looking very closely at what I was doing, and it suddenly made sense to me. And then one night, while in bed, I was listening to this song, and then I applied what we just did to the song. And present it to you, share it with you now. So I hope you will go away and take a calculus approach to life and apply general semantics principles and being conscious of what you're doing, being finely tuned, sensitive to what you're doing, what you're thinking, what we're looking at, and how we're doing this can make a big difference in picking up patterns, changes, and rhythms. Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, and I'd like to have a big round of applause for Milton for his wonderful seminar.